feels a little better. Than that.
I think it's just the Americans originally Air Force. So it's like
well, actually,
more of a space.
Hello. Hello. Okay, we'll start in just a sec. Patrick, can you organize lightning talks?
Hands up, anybody else that was interested in talking even briefly this evening, Mark?
A couple of months away. Oh,
okay. Nobody else? Okay, it's all yours.
Cool, nobody else.
Oh,
I just need to set up a computer.
Just give me that other one.
You don't need it, do you? You don't need this one, you just want your own? There you go. That's mine. I'm pretty sure it was working, but I wouldn't know if you... Okay, use that one then if you want. Well, have you got yours on Google Docs, have you?
No, it's just like a website.
Okay.
Just need to open up that page.
Oh, okay.
Just Tim.
Hey, Tim, can you help Sergey?
1024 by 768.
Yeah, I just never used this one. So it doesn't see anything.
You took the one that was parking.
Oh, this one,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Should we just put it back in?
You need 1024 by 7.
Nothing.
Jones on the web.
No, well, I guess I just want to show from the website. So yeah. Any website.
Okay, so that's probably easier using Patrick. Patrick!
Yeah?
Come back.
Oh, what lots of fun.
The screen is like flash or something.
If you want to, you can log yourself in or just use a guest.
Have we now got something on that, Tim?
If we're in the middle of Google, we don't have a web browser. I think you have an issue. But
you know, speaking to that, and you pull this forward so it's actually.
A few weeks ago, there was LinuxConf, which took place in Canberra. So it is an annual event which lasts for 1 week, and like every year, about like 700 people come up to this event, and every year there's more and more people. I believe like a few years ago there was just 300 people at the LinuxConf, so this year there were 750 something people at the people. So this is an event to which many Linux kernel developers come up. So nearly every year there was 3.0, Linus Torvalds, lots of like Red Hat people and other guys that actually developed the software that all of us use, well, most of us use every day. So it is an amazing event to meet the people, just like you, to meet developers and ask them the questions, what will happen with the software that you're using tomorrow. And maybe have your own input, provide some ideas to them, exchange ideas. So the event is amazing. And this is, for me personally, this is the only event in the year which I would not like to miss, ever. So I'd rather quit my job if there was any conflict and go to this conference rather than not. So this is the only one. Like this, I'd rather not go for training, nothing. But this is event, one of event in the year that is the best one, like in my rating. And if you ever get a chance to go there, I suggest you to do it. Well, I would like just to go through the schedule and basically the talks that I have been to, and maybe share with you the new thoughts, new ideas that I have got from them. So, conference went from Monday to Friday. The first 2 days were mini-conf. So mini-conf is something that is not officially part of the conference, or is part of a conference, but is not organized by the main conference organizers, but is rather they allocate a person who is responsible for a track. For example, there is a sysadmin track, or there is high availability track, there is a developer's track. So someone takes the responsibility to organize the track, and he communicates who will play to other people, with other people who will provide what kind of talks. So basically, they organize the whole day for that. So on Monday, there were like mini conf on high availability and cloud, advances in Linux security, system administration, develop automation and continuous integration, multimedia and music, mobile, free and open source software, and Arduino. Arduino guys, they have been all these days separately. Nobody have seen them. So I don't know. So I don't know what was happening there. I can't tell much about mobile force either, or about multimedia and music. So that is not my interest. But I spend most of the Monday at the distributed storage and high availability track. So this track was also amazing, like last year and the same as this year, because it unites people that stand behind the technologies of the cloud of today. For example, this year we had Sage Whale, who is the main developer and of CephFS and Ceph basically storage, which is the base of OpenStack for the storage and any other. And there was a developer, Mark, don't remember his family name, from GlusterFS team, who was flown from the United States just for 2 days to give a talk at the conference, at the MiniConf. So these two, well, to give you an idea, GlusterFS and CephFS are the only, basically, the major two competitors in the storage for the cloud at the moment today. So GlusterFS is driven by Red Hat, who bought the company and that is behind GlusterFS development. And CephFS has its own company behind it, like of about 20 people. Yeah, it's called InkSpace, and it is led by Sage Whale, who was at the conference. So Sage and Mark had an open discussion with each other on what are the good things about ClusterFS, what are the good things about CephFS? So this was very interesting. And for myself, I understood that basically production ready is only ClusterFS. CephFS is not production ready. Concepts of both of them are quite similar. All of them use basically on the nodes, you export one of the file systems. You export it kind of to the cloud. So you create, for example, the XT4 or normally XFS file system. You call it a brick, like in the ClusterFS terminology, and export it to the cloud. And all the nodes do the same. And then there is some kind of calculation happening on where should information, what of the nodes information should be stored. And it is normally stored with in such a way that there is redundancy. So the same block of data would be saved in like three different locations. And well, and the people can provide the level of redundancy that you want. So that's the idea behind Cluster and Ceph. Well, of course you have to pay more, obviously. Because the same data is stored in three places, that means like, yeah, it's the same as RAID, redundant array of independent disks. Same idea, but it is like to the cloud. And another interesting thing for myself in this respect is that I previously thought that CephFS is a file system, which is the case. But CephFS is a file system, but Ceph is not a file system. And even Wikipedia is wrong. So Ceph has nothing to do with the file system. Ceph is a block storage layer. So it's the same as S3 for Amazon kind of thing. So there is like a block storage, just blocks. There's no file system. There's no POSIX semantics, nothing. Just blocks redundantly distributed in the cloud with a like Redis algorithm, whatever. And on top of it, there can be a file system. Can be, but it doesn't have to be. I also see that there was another talk, quite interesting, on Linux in Defense by Jamie Beres. And this is the basically every year, starting I think 2 years ago, there was more and more involvement of DSD and Department of Defense in the conference. They were openly recruiting, especially DSD, sponsoring and recruiting people at the conference. And this year, for the first time, they actually gave talks to tell a little bit about how they do things. Well, I don't know. I'm pretty sure that, I don't know. What kind of tour do you want? No, I wasn't at the DSD talk, but I was at the defense talk. Yes. Well, not just of college. I mean, if you want to go there, I'm pretty sure like you can talk to them. So the thing is, like, basically these years, well, it started in the States, but it's continuing here in Australia. So government is creating from scratch. It's like cyber force, whatever they call it, right? So some people that like train all day and hack all day on like breaking stuff from in China or whatever in foreign countries. And that's it. Well, I can tell you that Defense is the biggest customer of Red Hat in Australia, at least. It is the biggest. So it's strategic. And the same is in the States, I believe, like anywhere. Like, I think globally, Red Hat, like, has the biggest customer of Red Hat in almost any country is Defense. And even countries like Russia are considering using Red Hat. At the moment, they just recompiled their own distro, a Red Hat based, obviously, but they're considering to use more of Red Hat. And I know, like, I went to Russia like for a few weeks, and some of the ministries use Red Hat there, like finance and some others. So Red Hat is number one in government, basically, and corporate sphere. Say News Limited, they use just Red Hat. Well, that's true. And defense, for example, they have difficulty of getting support from Red Hat, and Red Hat has a difficulty of providing support to defense because they cannot actually apply, for example, source reports, like reports of information, because everything is top secret, right? And even discussing like technical issues, they have to rephrase it, and then people can't understand what they mean. So exactly, that's what happens. And I've heard like stories when even the conference calls have been basically like there's a conference call, like discussing technical issue, and then they find out that some of the parties are overseas, and just conference calls is dropped. Right? That's what happens. Well. And it is very interesting because like this talk gave a little bit of an insight into how advanced they are, like advanced in the quotes, right? So there's no, for example, no virtualization at all used in defense, right? There's no basically provisioning used there. Everything is done manually and systems are not even patched, right? There's no patching. There's nothing like that. Sorry. Yeah.
Hi?
Yes. So, okay, cool. So basically, yeah, there's a kind of a bit of a paradox that when people who care about security are the least secure because they just don't patch, they don't do that. They don't trust anybody, and as a result, they don't do anything. So another interesting talk, so basically every year we see Andrew Trigil, who is the guy who developed Samba, and Andrew Bonnet. Well, basically the main, Trich, he developed Async that most of the people use here, and Samba, right? So these people come up to the conference every year. And this year they gave a talk about like Samba 4 that has just recently been released. So Samba 4, like for the first time, it has an, it can act fully, like basically fully as a, Active Directory controller, and it has basically, well, nearly all the features, including group policies, which basically never had before. It has been lacking. But an interesting thing for me, observation, is that Red Hat, who is also will be shipping Samba, but they will be shipping it with Kerberos disabled. So the basically Samba cannot be used as a domain controller in Red Hat. Will not be able you. Nobody will be able to use it as Active Directory controller in Red Hat, although it's kind of like the biggest killer feature of Samba 4. And the reason for that is like Samba, they use Heimdall implementation of Kerberos, while Red Hat kind of bets completely on MIT. So Red Hat will be shipping Samba 4 with Kerberos disabled, just for some people. So basically, originally, I don't know if people know here about Kerberos. They do? Okay. So basically, Kerberos is a protocol of single sign-on. When you enter your password for just basically once, and then like in Windows, and you can go on any computer to on any resource on the network without entering your password again. So the way this happens is that once you sign in, authentication server provides you a ticket that you can basically use for the rest of the day. It's like a ticket for 12 hours or 24 hours, and you can go to all the services with a ticket. And that protocol was developed in the MIT as part of Athena project in 1986 or whatever. But due to export restrictions in the US, it could be non-encryption could be exported from the United States. So although the software was open source, but it couldn't be used outside of the United States with encryption. And so what the people did, I think a guy from Bond University here in Australia, he developed his own implementation of encryption for the Kerberos eBones. And then this project was used by the Swedish guys, one of the Swedish university, and they developed their own implementation of basic encryption suite for Kerberos, which is called Heimdall. And so all the later United States would lift the restrictions on the export. So, up to date, there are still two implementations of Kerberos. Well, actually, well, two open source ones, which is Heimdall from the Swedish one and the MIT from Massachusetts Institute of Technology in the States. And there's also Microsoft implementation. So these are the main three ones. And Samba chose the Heimdall because they had problems with MIT, one with the developers. So they basically, they had no support from the developers. So when they asked questions originally, they were just basically, nobody was ready to help them. And the project was a bit in a mess, so basically nobody could answer that question, say anything. So they picked up the Heimdall. Another actually big user of Heimdall is FreeBSD, which also rely on Heimdall. Okay. So that's it for the first day. So Tuesday, nothing actually, it was a boring day. Nothing happened there, well, for me, at least. I was bored. Wednesday was the first day of the conference. Oh, actually, on Tuesday, there was a keynote by Ryder Perlman, so which is a woman who is, I believe she's behind Ethernet protocol. Can you tell? So. Well, basically, you can shut me down anytime. Because I've got like probably more than 5 minutes. Well, to quickly summarize, another thing I learned is basically there was a Michael Karisk, who is a maintainer of NFS server in the kernel, in the Linux kernel, and I think he's also used to be a maintainer of Manpages. And one thing that people mostly don't know is if you export like any folder through NFS, basically your whole file system can be enumerated and exposed to anybody. And few people know that. Basically, as long as you use CISA authentication, system authentication, which basically nearly everybody uses, yeah, basically people be like, it's not just what you see, like you export this folder. No, all your file system is basically exported. Because like the way, yes, everything on the file system. And this happens because like the protocol of NFS normally works. You just the packets, they provide like information on your UUID of the file system and inode. That's it. That's what the request is. You say what file system to mount and the inode number. As long as you know the inode number, you can access it. So the only thing you can do against it is if you use Kerberos authentication. In that case, you will be checked. Operating system will check whether you have rights to access that file. But if you use system authentication, then basically you can say you're root, you can say you're anybody, and access any file. So, yes, absolutely, new or old. So if you export anything, just make sure you create a particular file system just for that, for the export. Well, if we're in a rush, maybe next talk can come in. Tim, if you're in a rush. And I can come back again if we have time. Yeah. Well, I'm happy to talk to you more. Another thing is basically similar to this NFS is, so people should understand that when you use truth, it's the same kind of thing. There's no security behind truth, just a namespace, but there's no security behind it. So it's quite easy to escape truth. And another thing is people believe that, say, if there's no execute permission on the file, then the file will not be executed, which is completely not true. It is so easy. Basically, binaries are no different than any bash script. Any bash script or Perl script or Python script of anything interpreted language can be executed by saying, say, bash 5.sh, whatever. So, and it is executed. But the same is for the binaries. The only difference is that you use not bash as an executable, as an interpreter, but you use like lib, what is it, like some Linux loader, .so, and that file, and it will be executed. Another interesting thing is that basically for the binaries, you don't need even read permission to get it executed. Yes, well, if you have execute permission, you don't even need to have a read permission. It'll get executed. So it's just, believe me, basically, if you have local access to the box, then... I think we should have some demonstrations, maybe not now, but like I could show you it later, and you could show it later. It will be nice, like 30 minutes, 40 minutes.
Hello, Mike here. Oh, my gin. Okay. Hi, I'm David Lyon, and I think there's been other talks on the Raspberry Pi, but this is just another one. The presentation that I've The presentation that I've got here is just a little bit of a high-level sort of thing. I know that a lot of people already know about the Raspberry Pi, and we were going to do a demo, but we sort of ran into a little technical issue. Okay, that's the Raspberry Pi there. So we're talking about a very, very small computer for those people that haven't seen them. The Raspberry Pis came out of Cambridge University in the UK, and basically why they're a bit interesting is that they use an ARM processor, which is the black thing there, which comes from, I believe, a RISC box, which used to be, I used to have one, where? Okay. But they used to be expensive, right? And then that's evolved into ARM, has it? Right. And so what's happened with these CPUs basically is that they've ended up in mobile phones. And I think Samsung are the best producer of these processors. So basically, I'm not really trying to sell these, but I'm just talking about them compared to other Linux machines. Why are these good for Linux? Well, basically $35 and you get a pretty powerful computer. It's a fully functional Linux system, and it's actually a lot better than a lot of the old Linuxes used to be in the olden days. And these little fellas are more hackable than a desktop machine. So you've got more things that you can do with them because you can put your hands on them. You can plug things directly into them. There's a couple of good things on the design. One of them is that instead of using a hard drive, they actually use an SD card as a sort of a hard drive thingy. So that means that they use way less power. You get up to, I think, 32 gigabytes or whatever you can fit on an SD card. You can also run USB hard disks by plugging them into the USB things, and they'll actually sit on a USB hard drive just on the top of one, and you can just run the cable from there. They have decent graphics, and I have no idea how to program them, but it's got like a 3D engine or something like that. Right. No, most of the other ARM boards that are around, I've had a look at a few of them, and basically they go from about $100 to $150 to $200 for basically the same thing, so or less. And for $35, you actually get more than the $150 ARM boards. So this is a quick guide here. It's pretty much as easy as this. You insert the SD card, you put the power on, you connect the display, you connect your network, you connect your input, and you connect your display, and it's up. But you connect your display first, otherwise it doesn't work. And that's all you have to do to get them up and going. A lot of people buy them and just do that and then put them back on the shelf. And there's been around about 1 million of these sold. So here's just my example when I said it's a full function computer. Yes, it is a full function computer. You can run LibreOffice on it, which has just come out, which I'm pretty impressed by. And it can almost run Firefox. It's not very fast, but it's nearly. And there's even a PDP-11 emulator that will actually run on it. That will actually make it, and these things actually run the PDP-11 emulator faster than the original PDP. Right. So, you know, when I went to school, we had PDP-11s, and I was pretty impressed with them. And to find an emulator for them, it was sort of impressive. It doesn't come with one operating system. It comes with a few different choices. They give you a default one of Raspbian, which is a Debian sort of thing. And most of the things in it seem to work, work-ish. And they've also got now a shop, so they're trying to copy the iPhone thing. So that there's a Raspberry Pi shop and you just download your apps. It's all very modern. They've got another distro which is based on Qt for doing embedded sort of stuff. And they've got a few real-time operating systems for it. But there's really so much to try on it. Another thing with usability of them is that they've got a lot of built-in support of Python, and not everybody's into Python. You can use many of the other programming languages like Go or Perl or PHP, but some people give me a hard time and say, oh well, you know, it's never going to be a really good web server, right? Because that kind of board can never run Apache and it's never going to give you any performance. But I challenge that. And if you put something like Pyramid or Tornado on, I haven't run the benchmarks because I don't know how, but I'm very sure that that would give much better performance or as good on one of these little boards as a desktop machine or a server running the older generation web servers. Another little thing that makes the Raspberry Pi interesting that you don't get on a desktop machine is a little header thing that they've got up the top here. It's just a bunch of wires that are soldered on, and you get a GPIO socket on other dev boards. It's not a unique invention. The other machine that's on the market is the Arduino, which is, people know it, is that one. And this has sort of been the de facto standard for doing sort of, single board stuff. However, this one is much better than the Arduino. Having all the decent programming languages and that sort of thing just gives you a lot more options. They're very unhappy. They're not impressed with Raspberry Pi at the moment. So what I did with my one I started getting hacking with my one, and then I did a little breakout board. There's a lot of people that have got these breakout boards to sort of add things. And so I had a go at doing it. And I can add a lot of stuff to mine. And I've sort of got a collection of all the different things. just an example. I made some LED boards, and I've got lots of little display board things. You can plug, that's one of these USB adapters. They're sort of junk from China, but you can plug them in and pull up a serial terminal on them. I made my own Bluetooth adapter that runs on the serial ports. I can run the Raspberry Pi on supercapacitors, and they just plug into the power. Using the GPIO, you can turn it into, you can plug one of these things, which is, you know, a movement detector. So basically, to get a movement detector running, you just plug him into one of the GPIO slots there, and you sort of screw, you sort of screw this one to the wall, and there you go, you've got an instant burglar alarm sort of thing. Yeah, so I've made a few, quite a few things like that, and it's kept me busy. Another thing about the Raspberry Pi is that there's a lot of support for it, and this is a really big difference with the Raspberry Pi compared to a lot of the other ARM boards, because a lot of the other ARM boards, you basically had to ring somebody in China to get support, and you know, they sometimes didn't have any information. It was just very hard. Whereas there's a lot of documentation for the Raspberry Pi on everything. You did? You can. You just need to get a better phone. but a lot of things, the really good thing about the Arduino, this thing, is that you can go into Google or something and you can type in Arduino movement sensor, you know, which is this one, and then you'll get a schematic on how to make a one of these work with that, and they'll give you a code example. So you go in and you type it all in and it'll work, and it's really cool. And basically anything, if you just type in Arduino this or that, and you'll find an example of how to do it. The good thing about the Raspberry Pi is that that sort of thing is being emulated. And so you basically, all the things that worked on the Arduino are sort of now working on the Raspberry Pi, or if they're not, they will be soon. So yeah, that's basically my rundown on sort of why the Raspberry Pi is really set to grow over the next couple of years. Yes. Okay, so you want to run it from batteries. It runs about, I think it's 600 milliamps at, no? What is it? Three volts. Yeah. So I've got this running on a battery. Now that's just on a 3. It says you're supposed to put 5 volts in it, but it works very happily on 3.7. So, and I can also run it on supercapacitors, but it doesn't last as long. It depends on the batteries. Don't know. I get bored and, you know, put it away. Cause you could, somebody scientific could run a test on it, or they could do a calculation. So you could, okay, so if you wanted to do the numbers, this battery here is a 2.6 amp hour battery, right, running at 3.5 volts. You can convert that to joules or watts, and you'll get a number. I think it's 5 to 10 watts you get out of one of those batteries. And then you can take one of these, and if you know it's about 200 milliamps, you can multiply that by the voltage and come up with a number of watts, and then that's how you would do the calculation, probably.
It's 350 milliamps, that's a third of an amp.
Yep.
If that's 2.5 amp hours,
yep.
Multiplied by 3, it just puts down a bit of
the. Sounds about right. Yeah. Yeah, on one battery, but most people, this is a like a notebook battery, so it's a bit bigger. On one AA, it wouldn't last very long. No, because you need 3.5 or above. Yes. The processors are optimized. So if they've got nothing to do, they sort of go into a sleepy state. And there's another one. So this is the one that he's talking about. That's your Arduino. The problem with that is that it's 8-bit. And there's so many more things that you can do with like a real computer that, you know, the usefulness of these is... Oh, the Arduino is absolutely brilliant. 32. Yeah, well, and the thing that you don't have on the Arduino is you don't have an operating system by default. And, you know, but a lot of these are just sitting on the shelves doing nothing. You know, people buy them and then they plug them in and say, yay, that was nice. But apart from that, they really are a very impressive little computer. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Oh, just one more point. Tim and a few other people are trying to organize a open hardware conference for sometime this year. So there's discussion about that.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jason Haston. Let me flip through my notebook. I've been wanting to speak to you and contribute back to everything you've given me. I've come here tonight to see Robert Smith and to see how he has achieved a new role and new employment. So I haven't seen him, but he did contact me a number of months ago after we were working at the same place in the Rocks. Robert Smith, I did mispronounce his name. That's okay. I know he has a better half, and hopefully he's doing something very productive. So I sit here humbly before you, and I'm going to describe my job hunting experience in Sydney for the past 6 months. I expect some serious laughter. It may even sound bitter, but I also want to practice my public speaking before I start visiting Toastmasters, because it's been recommended. So Robert Smith and I were working at the Smarts Group in the Rocks, and everything was very grand. I hired into a corporate takeover, and sure enough, corporate takeover came on, and we were let go. I've heard that there's been many, many layoffs in the Sydney, in our beloved home here, and that's in fact true. Has anybody been laid off in the past 6 months? Thank you, sir. Thank you, Cam. Let's talk to you later. I'll appreciate your review of my public speaking. As far as Sergey speaks, I will be visiting Canberra Wednesday to see my favorite agency, Candle. Candle has gotten me two roles before, so thanks to Sergey for some enlightenment there. This will be with the Australia Federal Police that I'll be interviewing for. So I do have an active security clearance, as does Robert Smith from our previous employer. So the agencies are very mysterious. It's somewhat like a slaughterhouse where I'm merely meat to grind and to sell, and that is really how I feel, because there are very little technical agents out there that are skilled and actually know. So they just check these boxes, and they push you forward, and then if you make it past the agent's line manager, then you get to speak to somebody that is intelligent, like a HR manager at a News Limited, for example. No problem there. I did meet with News Limited this week, and I was informed that I did very well, but that the HR manager had resigned, and that I'll be put forward there again once his replacement has been found. That was one of three calls I had last Friday. The other one was for that role, in fact, was a gentleman had a crisis in his family, and he just couldn't come to work anymore. So I get there Monday, and they say, oh, we sent him on a cruise with his girlfriend, so they're going to patch it all up, and so that role is no longer open. Same for another role at Telstra, running Splunk. I studied Splunk all weekend. I thought I was an expert, but now it's another huge product. The scenario was, our employee his girlfriend's Japanese. He's going to go be working in Japan soon. And the next thing I hear that we're going to let him work from New Zealand, which is another island. Maybe they confuse that with Japan. they said, well, we have a Red Hat role for you. We'll talk to you Friday. That was for Nagios, but I did not hear from them. Also heard from somebody who wanted me to do a six-hour contract. And so I did all the thing, references and stuff, and not hear from them. So it was clearly the resume pool. We've heard of the resume pool of hiring managers wanting to talk to people in the past year, that they're warm, breathing sacks of water. It's a Star Trek reference there. I have had some luck, but I've had to leave Sydney. I went back to a town I used to live in Denver, and I worked as a Red Hat consultant in the data center configuring ILO. First thing we pointed out to them as consultants, Hewlett Packard sells a product that configures all of your ILOs in one fell swoop. And they said, yes, but we're not going to buy that. We're just going to pay you three consultants to sit here and configure ILO day after day after day. That was a great role. I got my positive reference. I was able to restart my career, and give this reference to the agents whom I so love. Any agents here today? Okay, no agents. So I usually refer to them as low-lying, belly-scraping slugs. But that's an affectionate term. No, they see that. They see that. I used to call them headhunters in person, and that doesn't. So agent usually works well. There may be a better term for the agents when I'm talking to agents, but I would like to know that term. I think that my inability to land a job could be related to my humor. It is hard for me to sit there for an hour and not crack a joke because I clearly have no respect for the agents. So I need to work on that, but I'm working on my straight face and just sitting there and being calm and not getting uppity because, you know, it's just a meeting. I am qualified or else I wouldn't be sitting here. So, you know, to know thine self is a virtue, something like that. So for the new jobs, there are very few new jobs. Most of them are backfill. So it's good for me to realize that. And in conclusion, I may have to rely on luck. I've thought back to all my other previous roles. Often it's been people I've known or I've just shown up and with some degree of luck. Third scenario is they've offered the job to somebody, but they refused it. I'm hoping that goes well with the Westfield interviewing for security specialist. I'm hoping that I had feedback. They didn't tell me I did not have the job, but they told me I was stronger technically, but not as polished. I've since learned how to tie a Windsor tie. Who knows how to tie a Windsor tie? Okay, and the tie that you see school kids wear, what's that called? Four in hand. So I've been tying four in hand for a lot, because I've never tied. So I've learned, so that's good. So I've now tied the Windsor once, and this may have been bad, but I was always happy about the tie, because when you see all the IT workers, they usually have a four in hand tie, and all the managers have a Windsor tie. So sitting in front of the CIO, and I had a four in hand tie, that may have been it. But other than that, we were all dressed identically: cufflinks, white shirt, suit. And of course, his was brand new from the mall. But mine was just from Crow's Nest. Yes, sir. It's an open question. How do people go to interviews? So the point is, generally, this IT workers, we show up to new interviews wearing a three-piece suit and tie, maybe a vest or not, but certainly a belt that helps. But we're Thank you, Serge.
I'm pretty sure I wouldn't get my job safe. I'd be appreciated if I wore a suit, which was considering.
the company culture.
Small companies have financial.
Yes, financial. So you just need to feed the company culture because that is what the HR is for. If everybody in the company is wears like sandals like that's what you should be wearing.
Probably female.
Thank you, Serge. That helps me. I will be using my social engineering skills and to find out what the dress culture is. I have been able to access the back room in Brambles just by social engineering, so the security is rather weak, just physical security. I've learned that it is a happy feeling family. That's what you're aiming for. When I first started, just years ago, I thought it was always like an HR department, someone completely else. But often it's the same people you'll be working with. So I was building up on some humor. So IT people are not good at dressing up. I'm not good at dressing up. So, but I've gotten better. And so I. What? Where is the LCA? I do have sandals. Okay. Myself currently. These are stretch Levi's from Chicago. So, but the shirt is from storage and is still dirty. But now, if I take anything out of this, and I will, I'm going to spend an extra day in advance, just hope, you know, finding out. Send the agent, because I'm forced to deal with agents. Well, I'm from KPMG, and I need to take a tour of your office. Thank you. Lastly, I have reached over 40, and I'm sure that it's to my detriment. There are many, many younger folks. I don't really see anybody here that's super young. Sergey is probably 29, or I don't know. There's a lot of competition. Telstra laid off 648 people yesterday morning, today, or rebranded. IBM Australia is taking a nosedive. If Infosys is taking business from IBM Australia, you know, it's very bad for them. All the contractors I know at IBM that I used to work with are gone. They have been forced to hire back some AIX people because they wrote everything, Angus Au, respectively. So I will get lucky. I'm going to keep at it. I may have to return to Denver again. It seems like the University of Newcastle is bending backwards to get me. That's going to be hell. But I'll be working in Sydney again because it is a beautiful jewel of the South Pacific. Thank you.
Yeah, it'll probably be only a couple of minutes. just something that I got reminded of at LCA in Sergei's talk. He was saying that he didn't go to the Mobile Force talk. One thing that was really nice there was the server project, which is basically put an Arduino on the back of a mobile phone. And they use it for a couple of things. One of them is for communication in disaster situations. So they had a talk about how they had a field test with the New Zealand, I'm not sure if it was Red Cross or some other emergency responder. And it wasn't the fire department, but it was some sort of emergency responder in New Zealand. It was on the talk list. We can look it up. But apparently that was reasonably well received. People liked it and suggested other things that should be migrated to this new experimental system, which is probably a positive thing. And the other thing they are thinking of using it for is that you can sort of use it as a generic analysis thing. If you take your typical medical device, which is like a large box with blinking lights, a curly cord, and a handset, you can take the bit that's the handset and the curly cord and plug that into one of those Arduinos, and hopefully that will cost less than the big box of blinking lights. Exactly. It's bound to cost a lot less, and there are a lot of places in the world where a couple of hundred dollars worth of spare parts for those big boxes plugged into a mobile phone like that could help a lot of people with sensors like anemia and so on, because there's somebody was giving an example that a lot of people die in childbirth because they have undiagnosed anemia, and that's a very simple sensor. So they had those two things, medical and other sensors being processed by these things, and when the mobile towers go down, the Arduino half can mesh and still forward messages, even though the network is down. So yeah, the server project sounded really interesting. Anybody else for 5 minutes? Four? Three? Pub?
I have your card for Tuesday.
Oh, it's